Amen. That's the welcome from our youth choir on this Youth Sunday with the theme for the year, Equipping the Next Generation. We gather together on this, our sixth Lord's Day after Pentecost, where we join to worship God in spirit and in truth. So we stand this morning as we sing the hymn, At the Name of Jesus, Every Knee Shall Bow. Continue to worship as we pray together the responsive psalm from Psalm 52. Why do you boast, O mighty one, of mischief done against the godly all day long? You love evil more than good, and lying more than speaking the truth. But God will break you down forever. He will snatch and tear you from your tent. He will uproot you from the land of the living. See, the one who would not take refuge in God, but trusted in abundant riches and sought refuge in wealth. I will thank you forever because of what you have done. In the presence of the faithful, I will proclaim your name, for it is good. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. We continue as we sing to him, what a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Number 288 in Voices in Praise. Seated as we prepare ourselves to go to God in prayer. As the songwriter reminds us, what a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege we have to carry everything, not some things, but everything to God in prayer. And this morning we come together in his presence as we bow our heads, close our eyes. And each and every one of us have something, some sin, some grief, some concern that we need to bring to God in prayer. And we are praying with the expectation, knowing that God promised that we are two or more gathered in his name, that he's in the midst of us. And his promise is also that whatever we ask in the name of Jesus, that he would ask the Father and we will get the requests that we ask. So this morning we come to God in prayer, acknowledging him as the one and only God, the true and living God, the God in whom we live, we move, and have our being. the God who is almighty, all-powerful, and all-knowing, the God who created us in his image and likeness, the God who breathed his breath of life into us so that we can become living souls. And even when we had fallen into sin, he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, out of his love. But the scripture reminds us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And we know, we've experienced through scripture, that Jesus came into this earth, the Word who became flesh and made his dwelling among us. And he journeyed throughout this earth on his purpose of healing, of delivering, opening blind eyes, putting wrong things right, and launching the kingdom of God here on earth. And this Jesus gave his life for us on Calvary's cross, but he said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will not leave you as orphans, but I will send the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, who will lead and guide you into all truth. And today we have the Holy Spirit that we can cry out to, the Holy Spirit that ministers to us, the Holy Spirit that leads us and guides us. So when we look at this awesome God, the God of creation, the God of love, the God of peace, we worship and adore him for who he is, an awesome God, a powerful God, the God who we look to for provision, the God who we look to for strength, the God who we look to for wisdom, the God who we look to for guidance, for knowledge and understanding. So we worship you this day. We praise you and we acknowledge you because of who you are, Jesus the Christ. And even as we sit in your presence, Lord, and as over the areas we hear and we sit in our homes and listen and join in this prayer, we know, Lord, that we have all sinned and fallen short of your glory. And we take this moment, Lord, now to come to you, naked but not ashamed, to expose ourselves to you, asking, Lord, that you will search our innermost being, bring to our memories, even now as we sit in your presence, those sins and of omission, the sins of commission, those things that we have done, Lord, that is not pleasing in your sight. And you know everything about us, because scripture reminds us that even the number of hairs on our head, that you know that they are numbered. And the psalmist reminds us that there's no way that we can go in this earth that you cannot see us, that you cannot identify us. You can go to the heavens, you can go to the earth, wherever we go, you are present. So nothing can be hid from you. So Lord, this morning, in your presence, we ask that you will search our innermost being. Purge us and wash us. Create in us, Lord, clean hearts and renew a right spirit within us, we pray this morning. As we confess our sins, we confess our faults, our wrongdoings before you. And we know that you are a God who stands on your word. So we can trust in you, knowing that you said that if we confess our sins, that you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So we thank you for your forgiveness this morning. We thank you that you've washed us and made us whole. We thank you, Lord, that we can now come into your presence. You said to be holy, for you are holy. And now we can come into this space, into your holy sanctuary. And we present our bodies to you as living sacrifices. Use us this morning in your worship. And we invite you, Holy Spirit, to come now and sit next to us. Come now and minister to us. Come now, Lord, and speak a word. Come and give us a hug and a comfort us. Lord, if there is something that is troubling in our minds this morning, that you bring peace, Lord. If there is a situation, Lord, that we need a solution, that you provide the solution. If there's a need for healing, come now, Lord, and manifest yourself as Jehovah Rapha, or healer. If there's a need for provision, Lord, you are the great Jehovah Jireh. So come and provide for us. Whatever the need is, you are the I am that the I am. So come, Lord, and meet us at our point of need. So this morning we declare that this is the Lord's house, and Jesus is Lord to the glory of God. So Holy Spirit, come now, take your rightful place. Meet us at our point of need, and may our worship be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. We invite now the steward on duty to come, bring the welcome, birthday and anniversary celebrations, and the notices before us.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Thank you for joining us at the James Street Methodist Church in Bridgetown, Barbados. A special welcome to those of you joining us live via our YouTube channel and to those persons here in the sanctuary. To any first-time visitors, we welcome you and thank you for choosing James Street for your worship today. This morning, we extend a special welcome to the family and supporters of the baby that has been brought for holy baptism. We pray that God will bless him and that he will grow to be a blessing to your family. We acknowledge those who are taking part in our service this morning: our children's choir, our organist, Sister Janae Burgess, our sexton, the hospitality team, the audiovisual team, and our preacher for today, Captain Reverend Al Walcott. May God continue to bless you as you touch lives through your respective ministries. Let us now turn our attention to the notices. Missions 2022. Next Sunday, July the 24th, will be observed as Missionary Lord's Day in the James Street Spikestown Circuit. Our visiting preacher this year is Reverend Dr. Oral Thomas, President of the United Theological College of the West Indies, Kingston, Jamaica. While he is here for our missionary campaign, Reverend Dr. Thomas will launch his most recent publication, Reimagining Caribbean Methodism for Contemporary Missions. Copies of the book are already available from the circuit office at Barbados $50, but the official launch will take place here at James Street on Friday, August the 5th at 7 p.m. And Reverend Dr. Thomas will be available to sign your copy of his book. The monthly prayer vigil will be held on July the 28th and 29th via the Zoom platform. The James Street congregation will be leading the second watch of the night from 9 p.m. until 10 p.m. on July the 28th. Our focus will be a time of thanksgiving and visitation. Our midweek midday impromptu recitals continue this Wednesday, July the 20th, in its third week here at James Street at noon. So far, we have enjoyed the ministries of Anderson Griffith on guitar and Paula Hines with her melodious voice. This week, we will feature Kian Walters, and we look forward to the three of her vocal renditions. Admission is free, and you are invited to make a donation toward the development of our music ministry. Once again, remember the admission is free, so feel free to come down. For those persons in the sanctuary, you are reminded that immediately after this service, Sister Janelle will host a brief training session on the most impactful and effective ways to use a tambourine and cymbals in our worship space. So if you are interested in being a part of this exciting ministry, please join her by the piano. If you do not have your cymbals or tambourine today, you can still come and take part in this session. Brothers and sisters, we invite you to join us for our various intentional faith development activities, and we pray that God's Holy Spirit will guide and shield us as we go into the world for mission and service. May the peace of the Lord be with you today and during this week ahead. God bless you and your families.
To be back live. Is there anyone in the sanctuary this morning who is visiting us for the first time? If so, please stand and so you can receive a warm James Street welcome from us. If you're visiting us for the first time, please stand. Welcome you on behalf of our superintendent, minister, and bishop, the Reverend Derek Richards, and all the members here at the James Street Church. We pray that your experience here with us will be one that is touching and that at some point you can come back again and join us in worship. If you don't have a family church, that you're welcome to come and worship with us on Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. Amen. So welcome to you and God bless you all. You may be seated. Is there anyone in the sanctuary who is celebrating birthdays this morning? Anyone? Nobody online either? You, Kevin, and two birthdays? All right, so get the spotlight on those two young men upstairs there. Please stand if you're celebrating a birthday. It's Kevin and Peter. You got them? There you go. Two members of the media team. Happy birthday to you. May God continue to satisfy you with long life. I'm sure there are some persons who will be coming up on the screen, but organist, let us have the birthday song, please. Celebrating wedding anniversaries this morning. Any couples in the sanctuary? No? Anyone? Kevin upstairs? We have happy anniversary to no one? Okay, so you still have the organist to play the anniversary song for those couples. Virginia, play something for us. Amen. So happy anniversary to those who are celebrating wedding anniversaries, and for those of you who are still battling on in the marriage covenant, continue to be faithful to the covenant. Amen. This time now we are here to honor God with our giving. And before we pray for the offering, I want to make an appeal to the members of the church and for those who are joining us in the diaspora and across the virtual space and the virtual church. There's a saying that the gospel is free, but the pipeline is expensive. And we also know that God loves a cheerful giver. Amen? So we know that during the pandemic, you would have answered the call and would have been given out of the abundance of your treasury, and we were able to sustain the ministries. In fact, we were able to advance with some significance the virtual church, and we are now at a place where that ministry has spread so far globally that we have partners and members who watch all of our productions on Sunday mornings, the daily devotions, and any other ministry activity that we have. Men persons are tuning in and watching us. But it was also an appeal for the anniversary gift, I believe it is called, and we were expecting about 300 or so persons at least to give something, but the response was not as we expected. Only a few persons actually stood up to the call. And there are so many other things that the ministry is seeking to do, but we need your sacrificial giving, and not just sacrificial, but your consistent giving to the work of the church. So we're asking again for us to give with consistency, not just to a specific occasion where you pull a lump sum and give out of that, but we're asking that you give out of the abundance of your treasury and give regularly to the work of the church. If you are in a place where you can give more sacrificially, then we appreciate your giving, and you can indicate what you're giving that service to. For example, there's the Heard Memorial Building that we are looking to launch a music and arts ministry, and it'll be open to persons from the surrounding community here in Bridgetown and others. So that's one of the projects that we are looking to do. In a long-term way, we are trying to start a home for the elderly and those persons who are not well, so we can have a place. There's no place really that persons who need that care can go to. So we are also looking to raise funds. You will hear more about that, but those are the things that we're looking to have funding for. And several other ministries that we would like to go. In fact, the operational costs of the church are such that the ministries that we would like to give to the needy, to the poor, giving to other charities, we are not able to do that because we are using your gifts to run the church in the operational sense. So in that light, we are asking now that we know that God loves a cheerful giver. And we know that when we give, Scripture reminds us that he will give it back to us, good measure, shaken together and running over, will men give into our bosoms. So prayerfully, in your time, you can look at your own expenses, and between you and God, you can decide on what you're able to give based on your own expenses. And if you can raise up the giving, then we're asking that you can do that for the work of the church here in the vineyard. Amen? 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 You don't sound too cheerful. Praise the Lord. So let us go to God in prayer as we thank Him for the gifts and offerings that we have received thus far. Gracious God, giver of all gifts, we thank you for the opportunity that we can have to give back a portion of what you've blessed us with for the work of your church here in this part of the vineyard. We ask, dear God, that you would minister to us, Lord, as we seek to see where we can give more for your work. We ask that you would give us clarity on the giving, clarity on the amount, clarity on the area that we should channel our giving. And we know that when we give, Lord, you promise that you will give it back to us. So bless these offerings. We pray that they will be used effectively for the furtherance of your gospel here in this part of the vineyard. And these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. As we prepare for the sacrament of holy baptism, we sing the hymn, Friend of Home as When in Galilee. The singing of the second, of the last verse, we'd invite the baptismal party to come forward to the altar as directed by the stewards.
Thank you.
God, our Heavenly Father, when every generation gives sons and daughters to your church, we pray that this child now to be baptized may by the power of the Holy Spirit daily increase in the knowledge and love of you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Dearly beloved, as we are about to receive this child into the church by baptism, let us recall both the promise and the warning of our Lord. This warning is that those who shall cause any one of these little ones to stumble, it were better that a millstone were hanged around their necks and they were drowned in the ocean. And the promise is that those who receive little children in his name receive the Lord himself. His promise of grace is boundless. The promise of the Holy Spirit is to you and your children and all who are afar off. He died for all, and all are in need and within reach of his grace and mercy. We are given the assurance that this child is also heir to that grace and a partaker of these promises, and that he who once took little children into his arms and blessed them, laying his hands upon them, will likewise favorably receive this child and give to him the Holy Spirit that he may become a partaker of his heavenly kingdom. Let us therefore hear the words of institution as recorded in the first gospel. Jesus came and spoke to the 11 disciples, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always to the close of the age." Amen. Father, we thank you that you have created all things and made us in your image, that after we had fallen into sin, you did not leave us in darkness, but sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior, that by his death and resurrection, he broke the power of evil, and that by sending his Holy Spirit, you have made us a new creation. Be present with us, Father, in the power of the Holy Spirit, that this child now to be baptized with this water may die to sin and raised to the new life in Christ. Amen. We now have the promises, members of the body of Christ, who are now in his name to receive this child. Will you so maintain the common life of worship and service that he and all the children among you may grow in grace and in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord? To the parents, you have brought this child to be baptized, and you will receive him again to be trained in the doctrines, privileges, and duties of the Christian religion. I ask you, therefore, will you provide for this child a Christian home of love and faithfulness? Will you help him by your words, prayers, and example to renounce evil and to put his trust in Jesus Christ as his Savior? Will you train and encourage him towards confirmation in the membership of the church and to serve Christ in the world? To the sponsors, godparents, will you, who have come to support these parents, help them in the Christian nurture of this child. Let us pray. Almighty and immortal God, the aid of all who are in need, the helper of all who come to you for refuge, the life of those who believe and the resurrection of the dead, we call upon you for this child whom we bring to you in this holy sacrament. Receive him, O Lord, as you have promised by your well-beloved Son, saying, "Ask and you shall have, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you." So give to us who ask, let us who seek find, open the gate to us who knock, that this child may become and ever remain Christ's true disciple, and may at last attain to the eternal kingdom which you have promised, by Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, whose blessed Son, Jesus Christ, shared at Nazareth the life of an eternal home, bless, we pray you, the home of this child, and grant wisdom and understanding to all who shall have care of him, that he may grow up in your constant fear and love through the same your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Merciful God and Heavenly Father, give wisdom and grace to the parents of this child, that they may train him and all their other offspring in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, and in the truth of your holy word, through Jesus Christ, our only mediator and redeemer. Amen. Before we continue, just want to say to the parents and the godparents that the responses and that you've made this morning are such that you are making a vow to Christ for the nurturing and raising up of this young man into a life that is acceptable and pleasing, and that we have a good example within our Republic of Barbados. So we urge you and we encourage you to raise him up, and as we are in the Christian way, and the word reminds us that train up a child in the way it should go, and when he gets older, even if he makes a turn off the path you've shown him, the right path, there is something that he has that would bring him back into alignment and to live a life that would be pleasing to both of you as parents and godparents. Amen? So God bless you. What then do you request for this, your child? Name this child?
Son, Lucas Allen Brown.
Zion, Negus, Nega Allen Brown. I baptize you with water in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. With baptism, receive this child into the fellowship of Christ Church and pray that he may not be ashamed to hold fast of the face of Christ crucified, to fight against evil, and to persevere as Christ's faithful soldier and servant to his life's end. Amen and amen. Brothers and sisters, we have before us Zion Nega Aline Brown. Normally we would walk him down the aisle, but because of COVID we went. But this young man has now been accepted by the church into the fellowship of the church. It is the responsibility of the members to nurture him as well. And if you see his face somewhere doing something that he shouldn't do and the parents are not there, then it is your responsibility to make sure that you put him back on the right path. Amen? So God bless you all as you continue in worship. We turn now to the ministry of the word. You may be seated. We have the Old Testament reading read by Brother Peter Millington, one of our birthday celebrants, the epistle by Brother Aaron Innes, and then the gospel by Kelvin Allen, another birthday celebrant.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Amos chapter 8, verses 1 to 12. This is what the Lord God showed me, a basket of summer fruit. He said, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a basket of summer fruit. Then the Lord said to me, the end has come upon my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The songs of the temple shall become wailings in that day, says the Lord God. The dead bodies shall be many, cast out in every place. Be silent. Hear this, you that trample on the needy and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell again, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah small and the shekel great, and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. Shall not the land tremble on this account, and every one mourn who lives in it, and all of it rise like the Nile, and be tossed about and sink again like the Nile of Egypt? On that day, says the Lord God, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your fears into mourning and all your songs into lamentation. I will bring sackcloth on all loins and baldness on every head. I will make it like the mourning for an only son, and the end of it like a bitter day. The time is surely coming, says the Lord, when I will send a famine on the land. Not a famine of bread or thirst for water, but of hearing the word of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. The word of God.
The epistle reading is taken from Colossians chapter 1, reading from verse 15 through 28. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. And you who were once estranged and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his fleshly body through death, so as to present you holy and blameless and irreproachable before him, provided that you continue securely established and steadfast in the faith, without shifting from the hope promised by the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. I, Paul, became a servant of this gospel. I am now rejoicing in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am completing what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church. I became its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known, the mystery that has been hidden throughout the ages and generations, but has now been revealed to his saints. To them, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of his mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is he who we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, church. If you could stand and read the gospel. This morning, the gospel is taken from Luke chapter 10, verses 38 to 42. Luke chapter 10, verses 38 to 42. Now, as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." This is the gospel of Christ.
The congregation may be seated. Let me acknowledge the presence of one of our members who is residing overseas but is with us this morning, Brother Gavin Warden. Welcome to you, sir. Pray that the service will be a blessing to you while you're here. So welcome to you. Let us go to God in prayer. Father, now as we turn to the wisdom and instruction of your word, we ask that you open our eyes to see, open our ears that we can hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to us through your word, and prepare our hearts that we can receive and accept your truth. So come, divine interpreter, come, spirit of wisdom and revelation knowledge. Reveal and interpret your word to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Luke 10, verse 42. One thing only is essential. Mary has chosen it. It's the main course, and it won't be taken from her. One thing only is essential. Mary has chosen it. It's the main course, and won't be taken from her. As we reflect on chapter 10 of Luke's gospel, we recognize that the gospel started first with Jesus sending out the 72 into the mission field and launching the need for persons to go out, laborers, to go into the harvest, the plentiful harvest, as he mentioned, and take the gospel, take the word of Christ into the hearts and the minds of the people who need to hear that Jesus saves. And then he went on in the text to show the importance of showing mercy while you're out on the mission field, while you're out in the cosmos, in the world. And what he did was he had a conversation with a ruler of the law, someone who was versed in the law. And in that conversation, he then asked the Jesus to explain who then is your neighbor. And Jesus, you know the story of the parable of the Samaritan, where Jesus used that parable to explain the importance of showing mercy to persons. So he sent them out, and then he used this parable, I believe, to then speak to others about not being selective of who we work with, but to show mercy and to everyone that we're coming across it. But here this morning, we have the end of the chapter, and here we are told in the text that Jesus was continuing his journey into Jerusalem, and he stopped in a certain village. And in stopping there, a woman by the name of Martha welcomed him to her home. Luke's gospel does not tell us the name of the village, but we know from Scripture, especially from John chapter 12, verse 1 and following, that he was referring to the village called Bethany. This was a village where Martha, Mary, and Lazarus had their home, where they lived. And we know that because it was also the place where Jesus was anointed by Mary with that very expensive nard, another familiar text that we read in the Scriptures. John's Gospel says that 6 days before the Passover celebrations began, Jesus arrived in Bethany, the home of Lazarus, the man he had raised from the dead. So Jesus had a close relationship with this family. He had raised Lazarus from the dead, and he kept his connection with them. And it says that a dinner was prepared in Jesus' honor. Martha served. Don't forget that. Martha served, and Lazarus was among those who ate with him. Then Mary took a 12-ounce jar of expensive perfume made with essence of nard, and she anointed Jesus' feet, wiping his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance. But this is to show us and to let us know then that the village that Jesus, that Luke was speaking of, was Bethany, where Martha, Mary, and Lazarus resided in that village. But in the account, the service of the sisters, Martha and Mary, are here highlighted as Jesus entered into their home. Martha, we are told in the text, welcomed Jesus, and immediately Martha started to put all of her efforts in making him feel welcome. While Mary, on the other hand, immediately sat at Jesus' feet and listened to his teachings. So we see here that two sisters in the same home had two different ministries or two different responses to Jesus coming to them. Martha was inclined to go and do the helping and the service, and Mary was inclined to just simply sit in his presence and listen to his word coming to her. So Martha then, we can say, was operating in her gifting, because automatically Martha went to ensure that Jesus and the disciples were taken care of. She did not have to be prompted or asked to do anything as it related to being hospitable to Jesus and the people there. She knew what was required, and she went immediately ensuring that the guests were comfortable. So the point we're making here is that Martha was operating in her gifting. So when the situation came that she needed to move and to make sure that the persons were comfortable, that there was some sort of hospitality that was being shown to them, she automatically went to work. She was in her comfort zone, and she knew exactly what was required, ensuring that the guests, Jesus and them, were comfortable and that they were fed. However, when we are in our gifting, as in the case of Martha here, she got so busy with the preparations, she got so busy and comfortable in the things that she can do easily, that she became distracted with the work of preparing and serving as she sought to please Jesus. And the text shows us that when Jesus interacted with her, she was not wrong in showing hospitality and mercy to Jesus and being helpful and making sure that they had something to eat. But in doing that, she forgot, and she became distracted from serving Jesus, from paying attention to Jesus. So it means that she took her eyes off of Jesus, who was present, and was more focused and concentrated on doing the service that she knew was pleasing and that she was comfortable in doing. And in so doing, she got so engrossed in just doing the work that she became miserable and irritated. Her intentions were good. What she was doing was the right thing to do, but she became so engrossed in her service and work that she got frustrated. And she looked then to rebuke her sister Mary for not helping her. So Martha took her eyes off of Jesus. She became engrossed in service to the point where she became frustrated. She became fretful. She was passionate about serving Jesus. And in the process of the work, she did not recognize that she was also neglecting him. In the process of the work and of the service, she did not recognize that she was neglecting Jesus. And we'll touch on that a little later. But why do we say that Martha's gift was probably hospitality and helps? Because if we go to John chapter 12 and verse 2, it is recorded that Martha again in that text, prepared a dinner for Jesus. So she was comfortable in hospitality. She was comfortable in helps. And she not only prepared the meal, but she served it. And that is the proof where we can say then that Martha's gifting was one where she was passionate about hospitality, about helps, and taking care of persons. She was in her element. She had all the good intentions. She was passionate about what she was doing. But in so doing, she forgot, as the text tells us, the important part. And the important part is that we need to sit at the feet of Jesus. We need to take time out to sit at the feet of Jesus. And this morning, in this simple text, as we reflect on this passage, a passage that we've heard several times over and over again, maybe as we reflect this morning, we too are busy doing the work. And this work can be our own secular jobs, it could be our own private business, or it could be church work, but we are busy doing the work. We are busy engaged in service. We are busy with ministry for the kingdom, prison ministry, feeding the less fortunate, all these things. We are busy doing these things for Jesus. But when we reflect this morning, we recognize that we are not spending time with Him. We are busy doing the work and the service, and we are not spending time with them. Maybe also, if we reflect on our own lives, we will recognize that sometimes we become frustrated and fretful. And it's to the point where in our own setting today, in the church, we start to complain. And in many cases, some of us have given up the work. We say, I've been doing it for so long, I'm done. Because everything is falling on my shoulders. Because we become overwhelmed. And the ministry gifts that we have, instead of there being there to edify the church and to build the kingdom and to glorify God, their gifts are being used by us for self-serving pleasure, its areas. And we are using the gifts and the ministries so that we can build ourselves up. And in so doing, what is shown here with the situation with Martha is that she missed the mark, got engrossed in her ministry gifts, and took her eyes off of serving Jesus. She took her eyes off the source of her strength. She took her eyes off the person who gives her the energy and the goal to continue and continue. But instead, because of her gifts, because of her skills, because of the ability that she had now to quickly put together a meal and to make sure that persons were comfortable, she thought she could do it on her own. Scripture reminds us then that we all need to ask if we have been busy doing service, ministry or work for Jesus, that we are not spending time with Him. We need to ask ourselves this: am I so busy in doing service? Am I so busy and caught up in the finances? Am I so busy and caught up in the children's ministry? Am I so busy and caught up with the multimedia and media team? Am I so busy and caught up with the hospitality? Am I so busy and caught up with all these ministries that in my time, am I a preacher and all I do is prepare sermons and I don't spend time in study or reading? Am I so caught up with the ministry gifts that I have received from God, that I'm not spending time sitting at his feet. And very often, in our reflection this morning, we recognize that our service becomes about us. Our ministry becomes about us. We focus on self and not on devotion to God. And Paul in Galatians chapter 6, verse 4, tells us about this when he says that we are to focus on or pay careful attention to our own work, and we won't have need to compare ourselves with others. And this was the case with Martha, where she focused her attention on, when she got busy and frustrated, she then looked at her sister to say, well, she won't even come and help me in the service. But Galatians 6, verse 4 to 5, as rendered in the Message Bible, says to us these words. It says, make a careful exploration of who you are and the work you have been given. And then sink yourself into that. Don't be impressed with yourself. Don't look at yourself and say, well, oh, I got this done. I'm good in my ministry, in my work, and it's all about me. He says, don't be impressed with yourself. And then he's going again and says, don't compare yourself with others. Don't say that I'm doing all the work and nobody is helping. But focus on what you've been called to do. And he says, then each of you must take responsibility for doing the creative best you can with your own life. Galatians 6, verse 4 to 5. And in so looking at this, then we recognize that Mary was the one who chose to spend time with Jesus. And she decided that she would show Jesus her affection rather than service. So Martha showed the service and was busy doing things. Mary decided that this was the time. Jesus was present. And what I need to do is to show him my affection and sit at his feet, sit in his presence. And we know that this is a regular thing for Mary, one of the things she did, because when we go to John's Gospel, chapter 12 and verse 3, we recognize that the text tells us that then Mary took a 12-ounce jar. She did not serve at that dinner. Remember, we read earlier that Martha prepared and served the dinner in honor of Jesus. But in that same context setting, Mary again did not help in serving, but Mary took a 12-ounce jar of expensive perfume. And she anointed Jesus' feet, wiping it with her tears. We recognize here that Mary would spend time in the presence of Jesus. Mary was the one who showed him affection, spending time sitting at his feet. So the question I want us to reflect on here is, are we so busy doing so many things for Jesus that we're not spending time with him? Is that your reflection this morning? Where you're spending so much time doing things for Jesus, but you're not taking the time out to pray. You're not taking the time out to read your scriptures. You're not taking the time out for Bible study. All you're doing is work, 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 ministry, 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 service, service, service. And the text tells us that that is not what Jesus requires. He requires that we spend time away from the busyness and giving him that affection and attention that he deserves. Secondly, have you set your priorities so that you can give Jesus your undivided attention? Have you separated your work, whether it's your secular work or your church work, from the time that you do devotions? And I'm not talking about drive-through devotions or microwave Bible study. But have we set our priorities in a way that we today can sit at his feet, that we can open up the scriptures, that we can meditate on the scriptures, and that then we can spend time in prayer, that the Holy Spirit can speak to us and give us wisdom and knowledge and understanding that we can continue in his work? And that's a question we have coming out from this text. Whether or not we are too busy in all the other things of this life and not spending time with Jesus. And secondly, have we prioritized our tasks, prioritized our calendars, prioritized our time so that we can have the right time and the quality time in the presence of Jesus Christ? And I believe that Martha did not recognize the time she was to step away from the work. Martha did not recognize the time that she needed to rest and spend time with Jesus. But instead, she became overwhelmed. And when you become overwhelmed, you will start to get frustrated, you start to complain, you get what is called burnout, because you're not spending that time away from the work, away from the service, in the presence of God, so that he can download some new information and give you that strength that you need. So I want to say also that today we need to be sensitive to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. Even as we operate in our gifting or our purpose, we are to be sensitive when there is time to rest. And we know that Jesus himself in his ministry always took time to rest. He moved away. Even with the disciples, he took time away from the busy ministry, so the disciples could rest. And then Jesus himself, God himself, took time away from the disciples to pray and to hear from the Father so that he can again go out and do the work. What about us today? Are we going to be a Martha who's just going and going and going and going? Or are we going to follow the model and the example, starting from Jesus, and taking time out to rest, to step away, and to sit in the presence of the Holy Spirit? So we all need to step back from ministry. We all need to step back from service. We all need to step back from the work and choose to be in the presence of God, where there is fullness of joy. Choose to be in the presence of God, where we can find peace and rest for our souls. And in so doing, it is the place where we are refreshed. It's the place where we can recalibrate. And those are the words that we use. It's a place where we can reset. It is the only place in the presence of God that we can find peace for our souls. We can get filled up again with the Holy Spirit. and then given a fresh direction, a fresh initiative that we can move out and perform the next task that he's given unto us. So in this small scene here with Mary and Martha, we can pull out of the text the importance of spending time in the presence of God, the importance of taking time away from ministry. I don't mean forever, but there's time where a couple hours away from ministry, away from studying the word, a couple hours away just sitting at Jesus' feet in worship, in prayer, can refresh us, can recalibrate us, can reset our minds and fill us with the knowledge and wisdom that we need to go forward. So when Martha complained to Jesus, saying that Mary would not come and help her, he did not rebuke her, but he said to her in these words, I'm reading from the Message Bible. It says, the master said, Martha, dear Martha, you are fussing far too much and getting yourself worked up over nothing. You are fussing far too much and getting yourself worked up over nothing. And then he gives her the solution. He says, one thing only is essential. One thing in our service, one thing in our faith walk is essential. It is not the work, it is not the busyness, it is not the service, it is not the ministry. He's saying that the one thing that is essential is what Mary chose. And that is what it's called here in this text, the main course. And he says that it won't be taken away from her. Jesus did not blame Martha. He cautioned her to set priorities, even while she was functioning in her purpose. And he simply was saying to her that being occupied with him, sitting at his feet in worship, sitting at his feet in prayer, sitting at his feet in meditation is the one thing that is needed for all of us in our relationship with Jesus Christ. And he called that good part the main course that will not be taken away from us. Why can't it be taken away? Because in his presence, we get wisdom. And scripture tells us that wisdom is the principal thing. In his presence, we get understanding. And scripture reminds us that in all you're doing, get understanding. So when we spend time in the presence of God, what he downloads in our spirit, what he gives us as the ways that we can approach life, cannot be taken away from us. But if we remain busy and try to edify ourselves, then it is easy for us to lose hope. It is easy for us to lose passion. It is easy for us to want to give up and become frustrated in our work with Jesus Christ. So today, as laborers in the vineyard, we are not to allow our service to Jesus to become merely busy work that is without devotion to God. Instead, I urge us to choose the main course, understanding that we are to set aside the starters, set aside the appetizers, and to simply partake in the main course of our relationship with Jesus Christ. Spending time in his presence, giving him your worship and the devotion that is due to his name. So Martha was busy, believing that she was doing the right thing. But Jesus tells us that Mary's example is the one that we should follow. Give him your full devotion. Sit at his feet. Partake in the main course, and it will not be taken away from you. So one thing alone is essential, and Mary chose it. It's the main course, and it won't be taken away from her. Let us spend now a few moments in silent reflection as we reflect on God's word for us this morning, reminding us of the importance of not allowing our gifts, our talents, and our purpose, our ministry, and our work to overwhelm us, to take us away from our focus on Jesus Christ, but that we should spend time, prioritize our work, prioritize our time, and spend time in his presence so that he can recalibrate us, so that he can strengthen us, so that he can reset our lives, give us a new vision, a new hope, that we can step out again in confidence, with courage, knowing that God is with us and he will take us through the journeys of this life. So, Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that even in this small passage that we can glean upon your direction for us as it relates to our own ministries, our own service, and our own work. Help us, dear God, to be more focused on you. Help us be disciplined in sitting at your feet in prayer, sitting at your feet in worship, in study, and that you would open up our ears that we can hear you, our eyes that we can see you, and our hearts that we can receive and accept the direction and the guidance that you're giving to us. So bless us as we prepare to depart this place. We pray, dear God, for our nation of Barbados. We pray for the leadership of our nation, our president, and our prime minister, and all the members of cabinet. We pray that you continue to surround them with godly persons, persons, Lord, that are close to you, and that you can use them to impact the decisions and the choices of our leaders of this nation. We pray, dear God, for our health services, our hospitals, our polyclinics, the doctors and nurses, and all the other medical practitioners. And even as we are still in the COVID-19 environment, we ask that you not allow us to become complacent, but that we will continue to follow the protocols and the disciplines that has been laid out for us to keep this virus under control. And even there, God, as we have had the first case of monkeypox, we pray that this disease will not impact our nation significantly. So we ask, dear God, that your balm of Gilead be upon this nation. That even as the contact tracing is done, Lord, that persons who may have been in contact will be found and that they too can get your attention from the medical persons. We pray for our young men and women of this nation. And we bring before you, Lord, the increase in violence with guns. And even, Lord, as we see sometimes on the social media platforms where persons who should be out partying and having a good time are finding time for violence. So we pray, dear God, that you, through your Spirit, will bring some control and relief to the gun crimes that are starting to proliferate our nation. We pray for our law enforcement members, the leadership of the law enforcement, the leadership of the defense force, and all the other security forces, Lord, that are there to bring peace to our nation. We pray, Lord, that you would expose all the areas where the guns are being kept, and that these forces can go and recover. And that we can live in a sense of normalcy and peace in this nation. So bless us now as we come to the end of this service. And as we leave this place, but never your presence, that your Spirit will go with us to our respective homes. That you will keep us throughout this week. Your Holy Spirit will continue to speak to us and lead and guide us into all truth. And that we can reach out to someone and remind them that Jesus saves and is still the answer for the world today. So bless us now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, the hymn, Jesus the Name High Over All in Hell or Earth or Sky, number 49, Voices in Praise. receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. And may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and abide with you this day and forevermore. Amen and amen. Go in peace, and may the peace of God be with you.
Week, everyone.